It's my great pleasure to have Mr. Vijay Chauthailwale in charge foreign affairs for BJP, the leading national party of India, to be here with me as my chief guest. How are you doing today?
Quite good. Thanks for inviting me here.
Yeah, now this is a perfect occasion at the backdrop of Horasis Global India Summit here to be able to talk about India and how it's the foreign affairs of India is going to shape into the future. And what a wonderful place we're doing this in Segovia, Spain. So, how has the conference been going for you?
I think conference is very good. It's a small and focused conference, very niche area, and the speakers are of great talent and deep insight. So I'm really enjoying their insights.
So one of the things which intrigues me is your kind of the work that you've done around thinking around foreign affairs, foreign investments, how to encourage more FDI into India. Any thoughts or take on that?
I think government has come out with a very progressive approach as far as FDI is concerned. There are some significant FDI, especially takeover of Flipkart by Walmart, is one of the biggest FDI investments in India. Even in high-tech area now, a lot of FDI is coming up. Of course, there is much more to be done, but overall, the scene is very positive.
Okay. In fact, that's a perfect question. So when you look at India-US relations, and now with the election behind us, and firstly, congratulations on the massive victory.
Thank you.
I think that creates a lot of political certainty over the next 5 years in India. So how do you see India-US relationships take shape over the next 4 or 5 years?
I think during Modi administration, the US and India relations have taken new heights. And in spite of change in administration in US, both Democratic and Republican, the bonds are becoming stronger every day. We have now strategic partnership with US. We are now one of the major buyers of high-end technology, including military technologies, in US. And US is making it accessible, some of the technologies which are otherwise available only to the NATO countries. Yeah. So it shows the level of confidence between both India and US. Even with Mr. Trump, as against anticipated complexities which a lot of people were thinking, the relations are so far smooth. Of course, there are some hindrances. For example, recently there were some duty exemptions were denied by US government, and there is retaliation from India. So these trade issues need to be resolved in a very amicable manner, where we will have win-win situation for both the countries, and that will set a foundation for a new level of partnership between India and US, and that should be the aim of both the governments.
No, then that would be a perfect backdrop. And how much of our kind of India-US relationship, you know, how does it impact how, for example, India-Pakistan relationship has played out, and how do you see that, especially with some of the tensions, you know, prior to the election, building up to that, and then now where we stand, how do you see the India-Pakistan relationship over the next few years?
See, good thing that has happened in last 5 years is that US and most of the other countries have now de-hyphenated their relationship from that of Pakistan. So initially, both the countries, India-Pakistan was seen as a club relation, and therefore everything you talk about India, you had to have a counter-narrative for Pakistan. But that is no more case. Now India has come out with a very emerging power, a very strong economy, which is growing by 6-7% year to year. And therefore, Pakistan is a kind of a minor irritant in India-US relationship, or India's relationship with other major countries also. We are based on the common philosophy of freedom, democracy, and respect to everyone, and also order of law. And therefore, Pakistan makes a difference, but it is not a major component of India-US relationship.
Got it.
As far as India-Pakistan relationship is concerned, we have made it very clear for last 5 years. We have actually done some initially, we thought to talk to Pakistan with Mr. Modi. But we have realized that this is not fruitful. Every time we took one step forward, we were attacked by Pakistan for terrorism. And therefore, now India has taken a firm policy that talks and terror won't be able to go together. So unless there is a very credible, tangible evidence or verifiable evidence that Pakistan has taken a concrete step against the terror apparatus in their country, I don't see any forward movement, significant forward movement in India-Pakistan relations.
Okay. And in fact, that sets the stage. So the other conversation that people have and people have in the mind is India-China relationship. How do you see that in a geopolitical climate with the trade wars going on and so forth? How do you see India-China relationship pan out now?
See, India-China relations has three components. One is, of course, we have a border dispute with China. Second is a very strong India-China trade relations and other issues related to the security vis-a-vis, and also part of it is Pakistan is a part of the equation. So if you take these three things in one nutshell, in spite of having a border dispute with China, there was not even a single bullet that has been fired across the border since 1962 war.
Yeah.
So we both countries are committed for the peaceful resolution of this dispute, and which is a very good thing. As far as trade is concerned, China has a strong trade surplus against India, especially in case of raw material, pharmaceuticals, consumer goods, etc. And we would definitely like to have a more balanced trade, and therefore we are expecting China to open its economy for the Indian goods and services, so that balance of trade is somehow maintained. And those negotiations are going in a very constructive manner. Third is all the entire geopolitical security issues along with China. So we had a kind of a conflict in Doklam crisis, where there was some tensions built up. But after that, when Mr. Modi and Chinese President Mr. Xi Jinping met at Wuhan, there is a lot of friendly exchanges taking place. And in next 3 months, 4 months, both the leaders are going to meet each other at least three times.
Yep.
And I am pretty sure that India-Pakistan, India-China relations are on a positive trajectory now onwards. And with respect to Pakistan, yes, China is supporting Pakistan on several issues, but now in case of, say, Masood Azhar terrorist listing, China has actually supported India's position, and I am sure that this is a very good gesture from India, from China.
But firstly, thank you so much for all your great insights. I think, just hearing your views, and especially with, US-India, kind of India-China, India-Pakistan relationships and the geopolitical environment and how you're seeing this. Just in closing, what's your ask from the Indian diaspora around the world to leverage, and how do you bring them to the fold for the sake of India? Any few words for them?
Yeah. See, India, Indian diaspora across the globe, which is close to 30 million plus, is one of the strengths of India. You are part of it, and you know how people like you have helped India to grow relations, not only government to government, but business to business and people to people between US and India. And that is an overall experience that India, Indian diaspora is very strong, financially strong, technologically superior, educationally strong in most of the countries. And therefore, what we are expecting, and Prime Minister Modi is expecting, that they should work as informal ambassadors of India wherever they are staying and try to build the bridges.
Okay. So thank you so much for your views today, and it was great talking to you, Mr. Vijay Chauthailwale, and we'll see you
soon
and talk to you soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.